The superior mediastinum contains so many important structures that it's better to consider it in stages. The most posterior structure closely related to the vertebrae is the esophagus. In the upper part of the thorax, the esophagus is a midline structure, but as it descends down, it inclines a little bit to the left, so that in the lower part of the thorax, as the esophagus passes through the diaphragm, it passes through the esophageal opening of the diaphragm, which is located at the level of T10 vertebra, a little bit to the left of the midline. The esophagus is a muscular tube. Now let's draw a section in the upper part of the thorax at the level of the superior mediastinum. This section is at the lower border of T2 vertebra, or it's at the level of T3 vertebra. This is the body of T3, or lower border of T2. Anteriorly is the manubrium of the sternum. The manubrium is located between the lower border of T2 and lower border of T4 vertebra and forms the anterior boundary of the superior mediastinum. Here again, I am going to draw the esophagus. It's the most posterior structure. It's a flattened muscular tube. And here is the lumen. To the left of the esophagus, in the upper part of the thorax and the superior mediastinum, is the thoracic duct. So this is the thoracic duct. It's a large lymph trunk that continues up from the abdomen. When it enters the thorax, it passes behind the right part of the esophagus. And then at the level of the sternal angle, it passes behind the esophagus to become on the left side of the esophagus and the superior mediastinum. It's important to mention here that this transverse section is oriented to match CT and MRI sections. So this will be the left side of the section, and this is the right side of the section. And evidently, the thoracic duct in the superior mediastinum is located on the left side of the esophagus. The next step, or the next structure that is located in front of the esophagus, is the trachea. The trachea lies in front of the upper part of the esophagus. As it descends, it inclines a little bit to the right. We will see why in a moment. And it bifurcates into right and left main bronchi. This is the left main bronchus. The bifurcation is at the level of the manubrio-sternal joint. Because it's inclined a little bit to the right, then the right main bronchus is more in line with the trachea. And as you can see it here, it's a little bit wider than the left main bronchus. Each main bronchus divides into lobar bronchi. On the right side, the upper lobe bronchus arises much away from the hilum of the lung. And these are the two lobar bronchi on the left side. Now let's erase the part of the esophagus that is located behind the trachea so that the picture becomes more realistic. The trachea has rings of hyaline cartilage that keeps the trachea always patent. Now let's draw the trachea in the section. It lies in front of the esophagus. It's not compressed like in the esophagus. The lumen of the trachea is patent because of the presence of the rings of hyaline cartilage, but these rings, they are incomplete. They are C-shaped rings. So they are deficient posteriorly, where there is a trachealis muscle connecting between the two posterior ends of these C-shaped rings. And that's why in section, the trachea appears to be flattened posteriorly because there is no cartilage posteriorly. It's replaced by smooth muscle fibers. In front of the bifurcation of the trachea is located some lymph nodes, which are called the tracheobronchial lymph nodes, so as the cardiac plexus of nerves. The next step is the pulmonary trunk. The pulmonary trunk and its bifurcation are located just in front of the bifurcation of the trachea. The pulmonary trunk divides into left and right pulmonary arteries. And as you can see here, it has the appearance of a slanted capital T. The right pulmonary artery runs horizontally, and the left pulmonary artery arches over the left main bronchus. It has a slightly higher level. So in horizontal sections of the thorax, the left pulmonary artery appears earlier than the right pulmonary artery if we are following the sections from above downwards, because it's, as you can see here, it's a little bit higher than the right pulmonary artery, which is more or less horizontal. The left pulmonary artery arches a little bit over the left main bronchus. And here is the origin of the pulmonary trunk. Now let's erase the structures behind the pulmonary trunk and its bifurcation. Note here that the right upper lobe bronchus is located above the right pulmonary artery, and that's why it's also sometimes called the epiarterial bronchus. And this upper lobe bronchus on the right side appears from the right main bronchus before it reaches the hilum of the lung. On the transverse section, we will not be able to draw the bifurcation of the pulmonary trunk because this is located just at the level of the tracheal bifurcation, and this level is much lower than the level of the section that we are having. The section is, as I said, lower border of T2 or upper border of T3, while the bifurcation of the pulmonary trunk is located at the level of the transverse thoracic plane at the lower border of T4. Now let's draw the more anterior layer, and that is the aorta, the arch of the aorta. Of course, the arch of the aorta starts as the ascending thoracic aorta. This is the aortic opening here. It's located behind the pulmonary trunk at its origin. And the aorta, the ascending aorta, goes to the right. It arches over the pulmonary trunk, right pulmonary artery, and the right main bronchus. The ascending aorta becomes arch of the aorta at the level of the sternal angle, and the arch of the aorta becomes the descending aorta to the left of the intervertebral disc between T4 and T5, lower border of T4. It passes to the left of the trachea and esophagus, as you can see here. And so it displaces the trachea a little bit to the right. That's why the trachea is a little bit displaced to the right. And at the same time, it compresses the esophagus. So one of the natural constrictions of the esophagus is made by the arch of the aorta, and the second one is made by the left main bronchus. Notice that the arch of the aorta passes backwards as well as to the left, and then the arch of the aorta continues as the descending aorta. The beginning and end of the arch of the aorta are located at the level of the transverse thoracic plane. Thus, the whole arch of the aorta is located in the superior mediastinum. This is the descending thoracic aorta here. And notice that in the lower part of the thorax, the esophagus comes to lie a little bit anterior to the descending thoracic aorta, which leaves the thorax by passing behind the diaphragm at the level of T12 vertebra. To focus on the aorta, I will erase the structures that lie behind the aorta. The ascending aorta has two branches, the right and left coronary arteries, and the arch of the aorta usually has three branches. I'm going to draw the branches of the arch of the aorta. The first branch is the brachiocephalic trunk, and this divides into the right subclavian artery and the right common carotid arteries. The second branch is the left common carotid artery, and the third is the left subclavian artery. These three branches spiral around trachea and esophagus, as you can see here. Now I'm going to draw them in the horizontal section. So the first branch is on the right side, and it is the brachiocephalic trunk. Then the second branch, left common carotid, and the left subclavian, the last branch. Again, I repeat, they spiral around the trachea and esophagus. The ligamentum arteriosum connects between the beginning of the left pulmonary artery and the undersurface of the aorta. It's a remnant of the fetal ductus arteriosus that short-circuited the functionless lungs. Now let's draw some of the nerves. The left vagus nerve enters the thorax between the left common carotid and left subclavian arteries. So this is the left vagus nerve. It crosses the left side of the arch of the aorta and gives the recurrent laryngeal nerve that hooks around the ligamentum arteriosum and then ascends up between the trachea and esophagus. Let's draw it on the section. This is the site of the vagus nerve between the left common carotid and the left subclavian arteries. And then it gives the recurrent laryngeal nerve that ascends up between the trachea and the esophagus. So this is the site of the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now let's draw the right vagus nerve. The right vagus nerve crosses in front of the right subclavian artery. So this will be the right vagus nerve in front of the right subclavian artery. And at this point, it gives off the right recurrent laryngeal nerve. And this is the right recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now in the transverse section, we can only see the right vagus nerve because this section is located below the level of formation of the right subclavian artery. So only the right vagus nerve can be seen because the right recurrent laryngeal nerve has been given at a more superior level than this level. So now let's continue the journey of the right and left vagus nerves. The right vagus nerve goes behind the hilum of the lung and it forms the pulmonary plexus. So as the left vagus nerve, it forms again a pulmonary plexus at the hilum of the lung. And then both vagi, the right and left vagus, will form another plexus. And this plexus is in front of the esophagus. It is the esophageal plexus. Branches from the right and left vagus nerve. So the vagus nerve participates in the formation of the pulmonary plexus at the hilum of the lung and the formation of the esophageal plexus in front of the esophagus. And the vagus, both vagi, they pass behind the hilum of the lung. We can see here even the left vagus nerve, after it gives the left recurrent laryngeal nerve around the ligamentum arteriosum, this is the continuation of the nerve that passes behind the root of the lung. One point to be mentioned about the root of the lung is that on the left side, the arch of the aorta hooks over the root of the left lung, while on the right side, it is the arch of the azygos vein that hooks around the root of the right lung. Let's draw the azygos vein and its arch. The azygos vein is located in the inferior mediastinum. This is part of the azygos vein here, and it is located on the right side, and this is the arch of the azygos vein. This is the opening, and you can see here that the azygos is hooking over the root of the right lung. Now let's draw the more anterior layer, and that is formed by the veins. The superior vena cava is formed by the union of the brachiocephalic veins, and this is this union takes place on the right side behind the first right costal cartilage. Each brachiocephalic vein is formed by the union of the internal jugular vein and a subclavian vein. The brachiocephalic veins are formed behind the sternoclavicular joints. Because the superior vena cava is formed on the right side, then the left brachiocephalic vein has to cross the midline from left to right. So it's longer and it's more horizontal than the right brachiocephalic vein. They unite behind the right first costal cartilage and the superior vena cava is formed and descends down on the right side from the level of the right first costal cartilage to the level of the right third costal cartilage. Here we can see that the superior vena cava is receiving the arch of the azygos vein, which comes from behind and crosses over the root of the right lung. Now let's draw the veins in the horizontal section. The left brachiocephalic vein, it's horizontal. It joins the right, which is more vertical, and they form the superior vena cava. And as you can see here that they are located in front of the arteries, the three main branches of the arch of the aorta that spiral around the trachea and esophagus. Note here that the superior vena cava is closely related to the pulmonary trunk and the ascending aorta, and they are both closely related to the transverse pericardial sinus. Now let's erase the structures from behind the veins. This is the site of the venous angle, which is the junction between the internal jugular vein and the subclavian vein. On the left side, the venous angle receives the thoracic duct, and on the right side, the venous angle receives the right lymph duct. The left superior intercostal vein crosses the arch of the aorta from back to front over the vagus nerve and drains into the left brachiocephalic vein. Now let's deal with the phrenic nerves. Each phrenic nerve is a branch of the cervical plexus. It descends down from the neck and enters the thorax posterior to the brachiocephalic veins. So this is the phrenic nerve on the left side and the right phrenic nerve. They are posterior to the brachiocephalic veins. The left phrenic nerve enters the thorax and crosses the left surface of the arch of the aorta in front of the vagus and passes superficial to the left superior intercostal vein. So here is the left phrenic. And the phrenics, unlike the vagus, whether the right or the left phrenic, they pass in front of the root of the lungs. Here, over the arch of the aorta, the phrenic nerve is located in front of the vagus, and in between them passes the left superior intercostal vein. And this is the phrenic nerve on the left side. The most anterior structure in the superior mediastinum is the thymus. It's an important component of the lymphatic system, lies behind the manubrium of the sternum, as we can see here in the section, and it may extend up into the neck or down into the anterior mediastinum. In adult life, it's gradually replaced by fibrous fatty tissue. One last structure to be added here to this transverse section are these two nerves that are located on the side of the vertebral column, most posteriorly, and these are the sympathetic trunk, the thoracic sympathetic trunks. Please don't forget that on the side of these structures in the superior mediastinum are the lungs.